This is the cartoonist kayfabe tag team of Ed Piskor and Jim Rugg. We're going to get into a rival tag team, Jack Kirby, Alex Toth. First, we got business.
I am plugging Street Angel, Deadly Squirrel Alive, and the Plain Janes. These are my two most recent comic books or graphic novels. They're available everywhere books are sold. This is the image collection of all the Street Angel, homeless ninja on a skateboard. This is perfect for everybody. And the Plain Janes, it's about an outcast high school students in the suburbs who turn to guerrilla art and public art to kind of liven their lives a little bit.
Boom. Patreon.com/Ed Piskor is where I'm serializing the Red Room comic strip right now. These are bootlegs that were printed from the files on the Patreon. Issue 1 is up there right now, serializing issue 2 as we speak. $3 gets you the complete archive on that. The X-Men Grand Design Omnibus, completely sold out, but might still be available in some comic shops and Amazon or whatever. But plug in the Ed Piskor Studio Edition, a giant book printed from my original artwork. And Fantagraphics is offering a steep discount for the holidays of their bibliography. And included in that mixture is the last remaining copies of the studio edition.
It'll be awesome when it's out of print. I feel like with artist editions, that's always the moment when I'm like, I gotta have this.
Yeah.
Now's the time to make that decision at home.
Because the price jumps skyward, you know.
That's the thing, man. Most of them don't get reprinted.
So I thought this would be a fun thing to look at, man. The artistic tag team, I guess, has probably only happened this once, man, between Jack Kirby, Alex Toth, with Vinnie Coletta doing the finish on the gimmick. And what we're looking at, I have so many comics with no cover.
Is that a 6-man tag team?
Freebird rules. This is a reprint of, I think it's X-Men number 10. What we're looking at is a reprint, X-Men 67, right after the way that the Steranko and Neil Adams era of X-Men and sort of worked, the way accounting worked at the publisher, they didn't get numbers back for like 6 months. So the numbers that were offered when Adams and Steranko were doing their thing, they weren't good. They weren't the Roth stuff. So they just canceled it and went into just like, just reprints until 92 or whatever.
Toth and Kirby are, you know, have been two of my favorite cartoonists at different points in my life for decades. And you read these interviews, like, they were big shots. And, you know, like, artist, fans loved them, all this stuff. Kirby moves to California and they get together for a barbecue. And I've read accounts from both of them in interviews. And it's essentially these two cartoonists with very different philosophies who were very good at making comic books. They get together, one talks for half an hour, the other one listens, then the other one talks for half an hour, the other one listens, they go their separate ways, have no idea what the other one was talking about. Two very different approaches to making comics.
So when you read, at this point in time, Kirby's drawing a million pages a month. He's doing the layout, so we know the Marvel method. Stan Lee goes off, gives him two sentences. When you see Jack Kirby layouts, you're essentially reading a Jack Kirby-paced story.
Right.
So it's a Jack Kirby-paced story with a little Alex Toth kind of flair on top of it, softened with the expediency of the Vinnie Coletta inks.
I don't know if I would have named Coletta as the inker on this. This does not look like Coletta to me.
You'll see Coletta panels pretty soon.
All right.
I can promise you that, man. Essentially, what this story is, there's an impending threat, and the buzzer at the X mansion is going. Yeah, the alarm is going off, and there's only one person that could set it off to this degree: my brother.
In your cliffhanger page, your brother.
And of course, I've never mentioned him before, like they did in those comics. You know, like always introducing family members and shit like that. Much later, we get the origin story of Professor X when he was a kid. And this is where Stan Lee uses writing flourishes that he's never used before. And what I'm saying is, the brother's name, Juggernaut's name, is Cain. So it's like Cain and Abel. Ooh. What do you think, man? It feels, in most places, more Kirby than Toth, right?
I was going to say, Toth is probably the odd man out in this because of the two bookends of Kirby and Coletta. That's very Tothian, that face.
Yeah.
So there are moments, I think. That's a very Toothian panel.
It is.
And I wonder, like, where Toth takes some liberties. You know, he probably stretches out certain stuff. Yeah, that's one that you would definitely find in some of the Toth.
Actually, the blacks here feel like a Toth stroke as well.
That's a thing to watch for, too, if you're trying to nail down, like, Alex Toth. So great in black and white composition. So, you know, whenever you see that stuff stand out, you could probably give that credit to Toth in this story.
Yeah. So they're preparing. We spent pages. They're preparing for this impending threat, setting up an obstacle course for this danger who's coming our way, man.
Fun sound effects throughout.
It is. There's some of them feel like Toth, you know, like these feel like Toth panels.
I see a lot of it in like the alarm sound.
Yeah.
It's almost geometric. It feels like something that he would do in some of his stories. That page is very Toth-ish, I think. I think this feels like him. This feels like him. Some bits and pieces here. It is a peculiar arrangement.
It is, man. This feels like a mixture. Because, like, you never see this, like, harsh black shadow. Like, Kirby does what he does, but he has a different level of thought. And this kind of, like, heavy weight of the black with something that's emitting light, like, Kirby never would do. Handle it that way.
There are several panels like that. To me, that's a very almost a golden age, early silver age kind of panel. It's somewhat generic. Toth has a decade of that. You know, like when he's doing romance comics and stuff, they're very well drawn and beautiful, but there's also that sense of, I don't know, 50s comics.
Kirby would never do a foreground character in silhouette like this either. Like that's a Toth choice. Very disturbing to see this this bald-headed teenager running around. It looks like Big Baby.
I was going to say Charles Burns.
Now we're going to get some Toth-looking stuff here, like this character.
Totally. Yeah, this page looks
and this
a lot
one,
like
too.
It.
Except those are Vinnie Coletta eyes, man.
This is almost Pete Maurice-like.
Yeah, it does. It feels like a weird Charlton. Kirby and Toth kind of cancel each other out and create like a kind of generic Silver Age kind of style.
Toth has a certain naturalism and it is completely opposite than like the Kirby sensationalism.
Yeah.
It is funny to pair those two together.
Very, yeah. It's Gilbert Hernandez popped on and ghosted a panel. Now, this is where you get to see the fruits of the spoils in terms of the obstacle course that was constructed by the X-Men waiting for our guy to show up. And it's just this looming, black, ominous figure showing up here, man, and tripping a wire. So earlier we saw Cyclops hollow out these tree stumps as they put military-grade munitions in the hollows. And he's tripping all that stuff up.
That's funny. It's like grenades that launch to, you know, head level or whatever go off.
This is super Kirby right here. But then you with some of the shadow and stuff, you could kind of feel the Toth in there.
It's great build up. You know, like here's two pages of this character, but we still haven't given anything away. It's still just anticipation to see him.
If you were following along in Wizard Magazine and calculating your net worth, it would be noted that this is a cameo appearance of Juggernaut.
Right. This is Hulk 180.
Exactly. That's a Toth kind of thing. Like when you see heavy blacks in this way, Kirby is a master of heavy black, like in his 70s work, Fourth World and Beyond. But I don't know about that in the Silver Age period. Now we got to get the origin of Juggernaut, how he became the human Juggernaut. When they were both stationed in Korea or something, and happened upon this temple, and Kane is such a dildo that he sees a glowing piece of radioactive ruby and just is like, it looks alive. I'll pick it up. What's the worst that could happen?
Turns into a super powerful badass.
Yeah, I guess so, huh?
That's the best that can happen, right?
Good stuff here. You feel it's one of those things like where you do feel the Kirby, but you also feel the Toth, man. This is a very like Vinny, what are you doing to us, man? Because I bet the pencils probably sold it better than what we're looking at right here.
Yeah, I agree. That's a rough drawing. You think of like silhouette and shape as something that you should distinguish. If you were to fill all that in, it'd be almost impossible to figure out what you're looking at.
Yeah.
And it's not much better with what he chose not to fill in terms of clarity.
Right. I think this is like the top of the head. He's bent over a shoulder.
I bet you this is... Right, I agree. That's what I see in this too. I bet you that's not what Toth envisioned.
No.
Some stuff got changed here, I think.
Didn't do very much Marvel work after this.
No.
This is a really cool image because it feels... neither Kirby nor Toth. It feels like a Wally Wood Marvel piece, man. He would have this kind of like perfect musculature with that kind of lighting.
Great beast. There have been a few of these shots of like the full width of the team moving, and they're always pretty good. This is fun too with the silhouettes of the team.
Definitely Toth. It's like he abided by and listened to Kirby here. And when he was translating it to pencil, which I would love to see what a Kirby layout is, like how full it is, because it seems like it's almost all there.
Yeah, I would be curious about that too. Another great beast shot. I was trying to think too, like what is Toth's timeline, you know, doing all the animation work that he did? I'm not sure when this comes out. This is mid-60s?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Kind of in between the his golden age... starts.
The X-Men were such a bastard team too. Like you could tell that it was like in the hierarchy of like where Kirby was putting his time, Fantastic Four top. And I
Avengers
guess
Avengers probably up there.
But he was off of that really fast too. Yeah. But I guess like when they talk about flagship, like it's literally like meaning the first, because it's hard for me to envision a time where like Fantastic Four is like the number one Marvel. It's never happened in our lifetime. But like what X-Men was, when if you read those early issues, Beast was the thing, and he was a big oaf. Let's take the blonde hair girl, give her red hair. It's the same, you know, she's there but doesn't do a damn thing. Let's not have a fire guy. Let's have an ice guy. It was totally just.
It's incredible what they evolve into.
Yeah.
Because it becomes such a huge piece of the Marvel Universe. And I don't just mean commercially, but even as being distinct from the other teams and the heroes, it really enriches that whole universe. But took them a long time of people adding like one piece at a time to get to that point.
Exactly. So these are the last two pages. These reprints come in an era when DC was doing those 80-page giants. So Marvel had to do their version and they would put two issues together. Once again, a little Toth energy to it, and a little Kirby in the mixture. But that juggernaut, pretty unimpressive. When you talk about like people over time having to play their game of telephone to add to the puzzle, need to be a lot of addition to this, man, to get it to an ominous figure, because that looks like a metallic turd.
Yeah, it looks a lot like that He-Man figure that had, like, the battering ram. That figure sucked bad, too. Like, no articulation. He would spring out of his legs. I had that figure. Talk about a sucky action figure.
Right.
This is pretty typical, though. You know, like, that storytelling of that time period. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm trying to think of characters that were introduced that got, like, the... like, an alternative to this. You know, what would... You know, I think that's pretty typical. It's weird that he's brown.
Yeah.
Here's my brown rave. But, you know, it's weird in the context of this time that he's brown. And I guess if you're going to do a villain, they're not the bright colors. But brown is, it's the least you can do, right?
Here's something I'm wondering about. With Kirby doing the layouts, which I'm imagining a little bit more than, like, the wireframe Stickman, did Alex Toth create the Juggernaut costume?
Yeah, that's interesting. And now that I think about some of like the different Kirby stuff, I think of like the Thor monsters,
yeah,
where you would get kind of a cool splash of like this great character design.
Yeah.
And this would be good in that mode. You know, like if Kirby made that guy full page and towering over the hero, you could do something cool with that design.
Yeah. It's just signing off, man. I like that image, like where the blacks are on that right there. And I think he's probably like one of the first guys to kind of have this all black treatment. Whenever Byrne would come along and draw these kind of suits, like Kitty Pryde, pure black.
Mm-hmm.
And this is like really the first time you see it, because usually it's like a dark blue.
Right. Looks good. I like that.
Anyhow, man, Dustin, these are out of the archives, dude. When I saw, you know, that we're having a tandem of Kirby and Toth, there's not very many more of these, if there are any. So we had to dust it off, put it under the microscope. It's just an interesting little oddity.
Yeah, for sure. As a Toth fan, I definitely appreciate seeing this.
And then just a real quick thing, man. Jay Gavin is the guy on the next issue. And there, the story picks up immediately.
Is Jay Gavin a real dude? Do you know?
No,
that's not a name that I hear much. I wonder if that's a bullpen job or something.
Maybe, man. Get out of here, Jimmy.
Yep.
Kay Fabers, like, follow, subscribe to the YouTube channel. Hit the bell. We'll notify you when the next vids are available. For the holidays, Jim's got a bunch of stuff in the shops, man. Octobriana's in shops. Plain James is in shops. The Image collection of his Street Angel work is in shops right now. Patreon.com/EdPiskor is where I'm serializing my Red Room comics. $3 for the archive for those. The X-Men Grand Design Omnibus is in stores while supplies last. And the Ed Piskor Studio Edition, if you go to Fantagraphics.com, you can get it for a steep discount before the holidays.
You can subscribe to the Cartoonist Kayfabe e-newsletter at the links below this video. I encourage you to do that and follow us because it's easy to miss everything we're doing. The newsletter will keep you up to date. You can find Cartoonist Kayfabe t-shirts and merchandise at the links below this video.
One more set of Martian orders, Jimmy. We'll be on our way.
Read more comics.